Hello students, today I am here with you along with my episode number 2, which is in continuation with the episode number 1 of physics class 10th, electricity. Today I will discuss some of the very interesting and very important physical quantities which come under the electricity, that is electric current, electric potential or potential difference, and the resistance. So before going into the detail, I would like to tell you that you might have understood the one of the most important physical quantities, that is electric charge, that I have discussed in my episode number 1. So I would like to recap the definition of the electric charge, and the electric charge is the property of the matter by the virtue of which it experiences a force when placed in the electric field. According to the second definition of electric charge, the electric charge is defined as the amount of electrons that is transferred from one body to the another body by the method of conduction or induction or by any other method. And the third definition of the electric charge is derived from the quantization of the charge. And as per the quantization of the charge, the total charge of a system is equal to the integral multiple of the basic quantum of the charge. And this basic quantum of the charge, this Q, is equal to Ne, where Q is the electric charge, N is the total number of electrons, and E is the charge on the electron. And the charge on the electron is given by E is equal to 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19 coulomb, C-O-U-L-O-M-B. So now this is the basic equation, and which is most important equation, which is very helpful in calculating the, in solving the numericals. Now coming to the next topic. Before going to the next topic, I would like to tell you one thing, that what is the basic condition for a material to be a good conductor. Now the condition, I would like to tell you one thing, that what is the requirement for a material to be a good conductor. So the condition required for a material to be a good conductor is it should have the free electrons or the loosely bound electrons, because the loosely bound electrons present in the outermost orbits of an atom is known as free electrons. So now let us take the example. Suppose we are having two materials, that is one is metal and the other is non-metal. So these metals and non-metals, they are having some differences which makes the material good conductor or a bad conductor. So what are these two differences? The one is the size of the atom of the metals. The size of the atoms of the metals is greater than the size of the atoms in the non-metals. Size of atom in metals is greater than size of atom in non-metals. So what is the condition which is required for a material to be a good conductor? So the condition required for a material to be a good conductor is that it should have the free electrons. So we will make it clear with the example. Suppose we are having a metal and a non-metal. So there is a basic difference between the metals, properties of metals and non-metals. So first is the size of the atom of the metals. The size of atoms in the metals is greater than the size of atoms in the non-metals. So if the size of the atoms of metal will be larger, then what will happen? The distance of the electrons present in the outermost orbit of the nucleus will be large. So suppose that this is a nucleus and this is the orbits. This is nucleus and this is orbit. So the distance between the nucleus and the outermost orbits will be large. And this distance, if this distance will be larger, then the bond between the electrons and the nucleus will be weaker. And due to this weaker bond, there will be a more chances of removal of the electrons from the outermost orbit. Now the second is, metals are electron donors. And the non-metals are, these metals are electron donors and non-metals are electron acceptors. As we know that the metals are having one or two or three electrons in their outermost orbits. So it is very easy to lose or to donate the electrons from their outermost orbits to complete its octet. Whereas in the case of non-metal, the electrons in the outermost orbits are 5, 6 or 7. And these 5, 6 or 7, these electrons are very difficult to lose the outermost orbits. Therefore, the metals are having the free electrons and behaves like a good conductor. Now coming to the next topic, that is the electric circuits and its components. An electric circuit consists of electric power, means a cell, a battery or an AC source. So we will get the electric power either from a cell or from a battery or from an AC source. And the next, switches are required to complete a circuit. Electrical components are required to complete a circuit. And the fourth is the connecting wire. So these are the basic components which are required to complete a electrical circuit. Now there is a table giving the components and their symbols. Electrical components and their symbols. So there are 12 components which are used in the electrical circuit. The first one is an electrical cell. So the symbol of this electrical cell is as shown in figure. Now here the thin and the large line indicates the positive terminal and the thick and the short line represents the negative terminal. And a battery, if we combine the two or more than two electrical cells, it becomes a battery. So battery is a combination of two or more than two cell. So now, as indicated here, this is a symbol of battery. Next, third one is switch or key plug. So it is open. When the switch is open, it means there is no current flowing through the wire. And if the switch is closed, it is indicated by the symbol like this. And this shows that there is no current. Fifth one is a wire joint. The symbol is like this. Wire crossing, the symbol is like this. Electrical bulb, it is shown by the figure as this. A resistance of resistance R. This is simply a wire having a resistance R. Variable resistance or rheostat. It is shown as given in the figure. The rheostat is a variable resistance, unknown variable resistance. And ammeter. Ammeter, it is indicated by this figure, and the basic connection of ammeter is shown here. Suppose we are having a electric bulb and now it is connected to a battery. So ammeter is always used in the series. So we will use the ammeter over here. If this is plus point, this is plus terminal, this is minus terminal. So this will be plus and this will be minus. Plus terminal will be connected to the plus terminal of the ammeter. Minus terminal will be connected to the minus terminal of ammeter. And this ammeter is used to, ammeter is a device which is used to measure the current. Electric current. So ammeter is a device which is used to measure the current, and the current is measured in ampere. A. And the second one is voltmeter. Voltmeter is a device which is used to measure the voltage or potential difference. Used to measure the potential difference. And it is used in parallel. It is connected in parallel in the circuit. And the symbol is, as shown in the figure, it is also having two terminals, positive and the negative. And the basic connection of the voltmeter is, suppose this is a bulb and this is connected with a battery. Now, since it is to be connected in the parallel, so we will connect it over here. This is voltmeter. Suppose this is plus terminal, this is minus terminal. So here this is plus, this should be minus. So this is the basic connection of the voltmeter. Voltmeter is always connected in the parallel in the circuit, and ammeter is always connected in the series in the circuit. And the last one is, that is galvanometer. So galvanometer is a device which is used to detect and see the direction of the current. So this galvanometer is also used in the series. It is used to detect the presence डिटेक्ट द प्रेजेंस एंड डायरेक्शन ऑफ द इलेक्ट्रिक करंट. गैल्वेनोमीटर इज यूज टू डिटेक्ट द प्रेजेंस एंड डायरेक्शन ऑफ द इलेक्ट्रिक करंट एंड इट इज कनेक्टेड इन द सीरीज. नाउ द नेक्स्ट पॉइंट इज इलेक्ट्रिक करंट, इलेक्ट्रिक पोटेंशियल एंड द पोटेंशियल डिफरेंस. सो नाउ टू डिस्क्राइब दिस इलेक्ट्रिक करंट एंड इलेक्ट्रिक पोटेंशियल एंड we would like to take an example. Suppose there is a flow of water and here is the case of flow of charge. Now we know that the flow of water produces water current. And the flow of charge produces electric current. Now there is a similarity in the flow of water and the flow of charge. That suppose we will understand through the example. Suppose we are taking a tube A which is filled with water as shown in the figure and it is connected through a small pipe at the bottom and again through a water as shown by the point B. Water tank. This is a water tank. This is a water tube filled with water. Now there is a difference in the level of water. So there, this is at the highest point and this is at the lowest point. So now we know that the water flows from higher level to the lower level because of the pressure difference. So the pressure at point P will be higher in comparison to the point Q. And this pressure difference will cause the water to flow from this end to the this end. And this is the direction of flow of water. Now since the pressure difference between the two ends of the water tube causes the flow of water from one end to the another end. Similarly, now concentrate on the point that since the pressure difference between the two ends of the water tube causes the water to flow from one end to the other end. Similarly, the potential difference between the two ends of a conducting wire causes the electrons to move from one end to the another end of the conducting wire. Now we will see that how we will produce the potential difference in between the conductors and make the charges move from one point to the another point through the conductor. Suppose this is a conductor and it may be of copper or zinc or aluminium or silver. So these are the atoms as shown in figure. And if the conductor is of copper, so there will be copper atoms. If the conductor will be of silver, there will be the silver atoms. So now these are the free electrons. So now in the conductor, the free electrons moving in a zigzag direction or moving in a random direction. So due to the zigzag movement of the free electrons or loosely bound electrons, they are unable to generate the
electricity
because they are moving in the zigzag direction. Now what we have to do, we have to move these free electrons in a single direction. So what we have to do, we have to take a cell. Now this is a cell. So what happens in the cell, I will tell you the basic requirements of the cell. There is a rod. This rod is acts as a one type of chemical. Here is a powder which acts as a other type of chemical. And when this one chemical reacts with the other chemical, then the redox reaction is taking place. And redox reaction is that reaction which involves both oxidation and the reduction. So here what happens? The exchange of oxidation takes place. Exchange of oxygen takes place within the cell. Within the cell. Second, exchange of hydrogen takes place within the cell. And third one is exchange of electrons takes place within the cell. So these three changes take place in the cell, and due to this redox reaction, the electrons are accumulated at point B as shown in figure. The electrons are accumulated at point B here and creates a negative terminal, and this area is known as the rich area of the electrons. This area is known as the rich area of the electron or electron rich area, and here the shortage of electrons are there, and this is known as the electrons deficient area. This area A is known as the electron deficient area, and area B is known as the electron rich area. And this creates a negative terminal, and this creates a positive terminal. Now, what happens? Since the electrons are moving in the zigzag direction, and we have to bring or we have to make the direction of the free electrons straight, in a straight line. So what we will have to do now, we have to connect this conductor with a cell. So what will happen? Since this is a electron rich area and this is a electron deficient area, this will create a potential difference. And due to this potential difference, what will happen? The electron will give the force to the free electrons and makes the electrons move in the single direction as shown in this figure. Now the electrons are moving in this direction, and the electrons moves from negative terminal to the positive terminal like this, because this electron and this free electrons repel each other, and this positive terminal and the electrons, this attracts each other. So the direction of the electric current will be from negative terminal to the positive terminal, and this is known as the electronic current. This current is known as the electronic current. And since the discovery of the electron was not done at that time, so we are using the conventional system of the direction of the motion of the current, that is positive to negative. And the logic behind this was that since the water flows from higher level to the lower level, air flows from higher pressure to the lower pressure, and that heat flows from high temperature to the lower temperature, so the current taken as flowing from positive terminal to the negative terminal. And this is the conventional system, and still today we are using this conventional system. And now from the above discussion, we will extract the definition of the electric current. So for producing the electric current, two things are very essential. Number one, there should be a flow of charge. Which will produce current. And the second is, higher the speed of the flow of charge, higher will be the current produced. So the current can be given by I is equal to Q upon T. So I is equal to Q upon T, or you may call it Q is equal to I into T. Now, where IQ is the total amount of charge and I is the current, this I is the current, Q is the total amount of charge, and T is the second time in seconds. So the SI unit of current is ampere, the SI unit of charge is coulomb, and the current is measured through a device called ammeter, and ammeter is connected in series in the circuit. Now, the electric current is defined as the amount of charge flowing through a body in unit time. So the electric current, now from this formula, we can extract the definition that electric current is the amount of charge flowing through a conductor in unit time. And now if we ask the question, what is the definition of 1 ampere? So 1 ampere, how you will define the 1 ampere? This 1 ampere, when one coulomb charge flows थ्रू ए कंडक्टर थ्रू ए बॉडी इन 1 सेकेंड फॉर ए 1 सेकेंड द करंट प्रोड्यूस इज सेड टू बी 1 एम्पियर द करंट प्रोड्यूस्ड इज सेड टू बी 1 एम्पियर सो व्हेन 1 कूलम्ब चार्ज फ्लोज थ्रू ए कंडक्टर फॉर ए 1 सेकेंड द करंट प्रोड्यूस्ड इज सेड टू बी 1 एम्पियर व्हेन 1 कूलम्ब चार्ज फ्लोज थ्रू ए कंडक्टर फॉर ए 1 सेकेंड